Hey YouTube family, look, I've put together this new video specifically on how to understand purchase and assignment contracts. It's one of the biggest questions that I get. Chris, what contract should I use? Does this work in this state? Guys, these contracts have been used by myself and my students all over the United States. I'm not an attorney, all right? They kicked me out of school, all right? So look, if you got questions, talk to your attorney. Have them make the changes for you. But I wanted to give this guys I wanted to give this to you so that you guys could understand exactly what you needed to do and how to fill out these contracts and have success in your wholesale business and get things moving. Much love. All right, guys. So one of the biggest questions I get is literally, how do I fill out a purchase contract, purchase agreement, whatever you want to call it? And so I wanted to shoot a video for you guys and walk you through this literally step by step. And not just that, I'm going to actually give you access to the contracts that I use in my own business for years. My purchase contract, my assignment agreement. Now check it out. Look, I'm not an attorney. All right. I didn't go to school for that. Remember, they kicked me out of school, guys. All right. So you're going to have to take this to an attorney. If you've got questions, if you need to make changes, whatever the case might be, take it to your real estate attorney that does your closings or that you are going to use for your closings in the future and have them walk you through exactly any changes that you'd like to make. All right. But let's go ahead and get into it. I want to break this down for you guys because, I mean, quite frankly, listen, it's the most important thing that you're going to need when you're interacting with the seller, because this is, guys, this is how we get paid. This is how we secure the property with the seller. This is also how we create an agreement with the buyer, all right, our cash buyer, right, in order for them to purchase the property from us, okay? So it's something that everybody complicates. So I just wanted to shoot this video and break it down to make sure you guys got it cut and dry, all right? So this is going to be like the last video you're going to need to watch on how to fill out a purchase contract. So when we look at this right here at the top, right, it says agreement to purchase real estate. Simple enough, all right, self-explanatory. So in this first line right here, this agreement is between the seller's name is going to go here. All right. You see where it says in parentheses right here, seller, the seller's name is going to go here. And I want to be really clear about this because I get this question a lot. One of the benefits of having, you know, almost 800 students in the past 12 months is I get to see a lot of questions. And one of the questions I get all the time is, hey, Chris, what name do I put on the seller line? Guys, you got to understand whatever is on the tax record, all right, is going to go right here. All right. So whatever name you see on the tax record is what you're going to put on this line. And you know what? I'm going to make it even more simple. I'm going to fill one out in real time. That way you guys can see exactly how to pull this information from PropStream. If you're using PropStream or you need PropStream, you get a 7-day free trial. Click the link in the bio. I said bio. Click the link in the description. All right. ChargedUpData.com. But let me show you guys how to fill this out because it's really, really pretty simple. If I can get this computer to work. All right, here we go. All right, so I've pulled up a random address that is, you know, a lead that we had come in, and it's a dud. All right, so you guys can go buy this or try if you want. All right, so I'm going to use a dud property to keep this simple. So when we click on property details, right here we're going to see owner one name and then owner two names. So this is actually a really good example. If there's only one name here, then you just use the one name. If there's two names, that means both people have to be on the contract. Essentially the way that you see it written right here. Okay. And so what I would do here, and guys, look, remember this is in reverse, right? It's always the last name before the first name. So you got to flip this before you put it on the contract. Okay. So this guy is Mark Eubank. So I would go back in here for the seller and I would say Mark, and what was it? Mary, I think. Candy. All right. So Mary and Candy Eubank. All right. So I'd get them entered in here. All right. And so the next line, guys, is going to be buyer. And actually, let me say this real quick. Please understand, whatever it shows as the owner name, that's what goes on the contract. All right. So if it says the estate of Mark and Candy Eubank, you want to put the estate of Mark and Candy Eubank. Make sure you mimic what you see reflected on the tax record as the owner on the deed. Right here, simply, we're going to put our entity. So if you're an LLC, you're going to put your LLC. If you're putting it in your own personal name and you're doing a wholesale deal, you haven't set up your LLC yet, you can put your personal name here as well. All right. So for me, I'm going to put charged up buyers. All right. I'm going to put charged up buyers right here. That's the buying entity that's going to be purchasing this property or putting the contract on this property. And I want you guys to understand also when you're talking to your cash buyers, just so I don't forget this, all right, we're selling our equitable interest in the property. We're not selling the property, all right, because we don't own it. All right, we're selling our interest, our equitable interest. The contract that I'm walking you guys through right now is what gives us that interest in the property, okay? So the buyer and seller, when mentioned together, may be referred to as parties. So seller agrees to sell to the buyer the property known as, and we're just simply going to put the address right here, right? So we're going to go back in. We're going to get the address. So 8811 Mount Olive Avenue, right? So we're going to put Mount Olive Avenue here. All right. And so then we got to enter in the city. And I believe this is Glen Allen. So we're going to put Glen Allen. All right. VA. And then we're going to put 23060, which is the zip code. All right. So you got to make sure this is filled in correctly. All right. So the next step, guys, is it says which is legally described as. All right. What this means is that we're going to put the legal description of the property. So I'm in PropStream. I've clicked on property details. I've scrolled down. Guys, right here on that tab is where you're going to see the legal description of a property. Now, sometimes PropStream, depending on your city or state, may not show here the legal description. You can check the tax records by going to the tax assessor's office for whatever the locality is for the property that you're working on, and you can see if it's listed there. All right. If for whatever reason it's not, I'll cover that in the next step. If you do see it, all right, which generally you will, you'll want to copy that. And you're going to want to go back and put that into your document. So I'm going to go back here under property or legal description. All right. And I'm going to insert, if it'll let me. Looks like it won't let me. Let me see. Let's just say it's XYZ legal description. I don't feel like typing all that out. All right. But you guys get the gist. Okay. You need to go here, copy and paste this, retype it. Whatever you need to do, but you need to get it in here as legally described. All right. So once you have that here, you're going to go back to where it says parcel ID. All right. So parcel ID. Guys, parcel ID references either the parcel number or also known as the APN number. So right under here, land and location information, you're going to see the APN number. All right. So you would do the same exact thing. All right, that one copy and pasted. So you would copy and paste that here. All right, so I like to do this to keep my contracts kind of, you know, clean and neat and on the same page. You can go back in and change this to the font and the font color that you have on everything else. All right, that way everything looks neat and matches up. Now, this is extremely important. All right, please make sure you understand this. All right, you have to reference a parcel ID or an APN number on a contract. It has to have, it either has to have this or the legal description. I would recommend always having at least a parcel number. All right, if you do not have that, technically it could be argued, again guys, remember I'm not an attorney, all right, but it could be argued that you do not have a valid contract on this property, all right? So next it says the parties agree to the following terms and conditions. Right here we've just put in, and let me bold this for you to make it simple. We put in additional terms, all right? So guys, again, additional terms. Now, you know, additional terms could be anything. Do you have a agreement with the seller to do seller financing, for example? Did you agree to purchase it with the tenant? Did you tell the buyer or the seller that you would do XYZ? All right, you would document and list that right here under additional terms. All right, where it says earnest money, it says the buyer will pay. All right, so my earnest money, I try to start it usually with sellers at $100. Now, I know some of you guys are just starting out. I know you're on smaller budgets. I know you're trying to make things work. I get it, 110%. You might not have $100 for earnest money deposit. All right, an earnest money deposit could be anything from $1 to $1 million. All right, now I want to caution you to use a reasonable number here. I remember back in the day, like 10 years ago, like common practice, we used to put $10 down as earnest money. Here's the thing, all right? The market is very competitive. There's a lot of wholesalers in the market. Every seller is talking to multiple wholesalers right now. And earnest money matters because from the seller's perspective, it shows them how serious you are about purchasing the property. So I like to start at 100. Sellers might ask you to increase it. We use $100 because I've found that that's a number that's enough where sellers don't frequently ask us to increase that amount, all right? But your contract has to have earnest money in it for it to be a valid contract, guys, all right? So it says the earnest money will be deposited with the title or escrow company within 48 hours of ratification of this contract. So ratification, guys, means when all parties have signed. So when everybody signed, the terminology in real estate for that or contracts for that is that the contract has been ratified. So if you ever hear that term, that's what that means. It means everybody has signed it that needs to sign it. So you're saying you're going to provide this to your title company or attorney within 48 hours of all parties signing this contract. Guys, you need to make sure you give this $100 to your attorney or title company. All right, don't put the number on here and then not give it to them, because again, it could be argued later that your contract isn't valid. And that's just not something that we want to happen, because guys, we want to get paid at the end of the day, right? All right, so if the buyer fails to close, then the earnest money will be forfeited to the seller as full, keyword here, guys, full and liquidated damages. So what this is saying, and this is a fail safe, all right? This is a fail safe that we have built into our contract. So let's just say for whatever reason, because you know, one thing I've learned in life and in my personal experience in business is that you can't anticipate crazy. All right. I hate to say it like that, but you just can't anticipate crazy. You never know when you're going to run into somebody that's just bat crazy. All right. And so what happens is crazy people sometimes might want to sue you. All right. And so if that's the case, this is giving you additional protection and saying that the only consequence that you will have is liquidated damages in full. It's just simply going to be that $100, guys. All right. And so that's a nice fail safe that we like to have inside the contract. So here, all right, where it says purchase price, buyer will pay the purchase price of. Guys, you're just going to simply put whatever number you've agreed to with the seller. So if that's $100,000 right here, we're going to go ahead and lock in and put $100,000. All right. And so inside of the parentheses here, you're just going to put that typed out. All right. We like to type that out so nobody can come back and say they weren't clear, or didn't understand, you know, whatever the case might be. All right. So we like to have that locked in right there. So we're going to type that out. All right. It says the entire purchase price should be paid to the seller at closing. All right. Simple enough. When the property sells, everybody starts to get paid. All right. So the property is being sold as is. All right. So the buyer is purchasing the property as is. No repairs or improvements will be made to the property by the seller prior to closing. So guys, this is something I like to lean into when I'm speaking to sellers and they're reviewing the contract, or I'm reviewing the contract with them, because what I'm letting them know is that we're buying the property from them as is. Most sellers, if they've ever transacted real estate before, they're usually used to dealing with the real estate agent. And in that instance, you know, there's the scenario of you get a home inspection and then you go back and renegotiate based on the property inspection. We want to make sure that the seller is clear that we're not looking to do that here. All right. And the reason we want to make that clear is because the very next sentence says, however, this agreement is contingent upon a satisfactory inspection of the property by the buyer. All right. So what this means is we are going to do our inspection. All right. And until it's satisfactory. And however, we are not going to ask for any repairs or improvements because we're buying it as is. All right. So we can give them confidence that we do need the inspection for our own reasons. All right. And so one of the reasons that I like to use in my business, which is generally true, you know, hey, we want to be able to get our contractors into the property to take a look at things
because I'm typically, you know, right now, you know, I'm paying you a little bit more than what we usually pay for a property in the neighborhood. And as a result, we need to make sure that the day that we close, that very next day, we start construction on your home. So we need to get our team inside prior to closing so that we can execute that, given the amount that you want us to pay for the property, which we're perfectly fine with doing. But listen, yeah, I'm sure you understand every single day costs money when we have these funds out extended towards a property. We don't make any money until we get a tenant back in place or until we flip the property. So we want to have these inspections completed, but it will not affect whatsoever how much you're selling the property to me for. And I'm still going to be buying it as is. Guys, here's the benefit. All right. This is also another out on our contract. So this is a wide open inspection clause. There's no expiration date on how long this inspection will run. Okay. There's no expiration date. So what this is saying is that for the life of this contract, we can cancel this contract for an unsatisfactory inspection. All right. And so this is a great fail safe that you want to make sure, regardless of what changes you make to this with your attorney or whatever the case might be, you need to have this language in some capacity in your contract. So if you need to get out, you can get out. All right. So closing terms and conditions. So closing will be held within. Right here, you put whatever date or time frame you agree to with the seller. Let's just call it 30 days, which is pretty common in the industry. So we'll say 30 days. I want to point out a couple of things to you guys. The reason I use the word within, all right, within 30 days is because we have 30 days, but let's just say it's a hot property and I find a buyer that wants to buy my property within a week. And then that buyer is ready to close as soon as title comes back in another 7 days. So that's only 14 days. Well, I don't want to have to wait another 30 or another 16 days before I can get paid my assignment fee and the buyer can close on the property. So we like to have within 30 days, and we set that expectation with the seller up front, guys, in that conversation and let them know, hey, this is the time frame that we're going to close within. At max, it'll be 30 days, and we'll keep you in the loop and keep you abreast of what's going on so that you can manage things on your end. But we'll definitely close within 30 days. Now, this is something that I like that we've slid in here that we don't get any pushback on whatsoever. So instead of using a straight 30 calendar days, we've adjusted this and it says business days. All right. So it cuts out that weekend time and actually extends out the contract by 4 to 6 days, I guess. Right. So it gives you some additional time, which can really come in handy on those harder to move properties that you need more time to market and find a buyer for. The buyer will choose the closing agent and the buyer will pay for all escrow and or closing company costs. All right. So this means that we will pay for the closing cost to do the transaction. If you do not plan to pay for the seller's closing cost, you need to change this sentence, all right, to not reflect that you'll be paying for the closing cost. All right, because it says very clearly right here that you'd pay for all costs. All right. And so the rest of this paragraph is pretty self-explanatory. It's talking about the deed that will be transferred at closing, that the title will be free and clear with no liens or encumbrances. So guys, if there's liens on the property or anything like that, those are all cleared prior to the sale. So the sale won't go through, won't be completed. There will not be a closing until those items are taken care of. If the property is leased and at the time of closing, then rents will be prorated. That just simply means that rent will then be prorated based on the date that you purchase. Not really too big of a thing that you've got to worry about if you're wholesaling. All right. If you've got a question on that, ask it here in the comments. I'll be happy to answer it for you. All right. But it's pretty self-explanatory. All right. Now, this also says right here. All right. And this is one of the most important things in this thing. Right. It says the agreement is assignable. All right. That gives us the ability to transfer our equitable interest in this contract to an end buyer. All right, guys, in some shape or form, you have to make sure that this is in your contract somewhere. All right. Now, there are attorneys that I've spoken with that will argue that if a contract says nothing about assignments, then it's perfectly assignable unless it says assignments are not allowed. I prefer to still have my contract because I don't want to run into a situation. Somebody comes back and says they didn't understand or, hey, Chris, you didn't. I'd rather just have it in there. All right. So access to the property. This is one of the other big ones. All right. Yeah. And this is important to have in there because access is never an issue until it is. All right. So we have this inside the contract. Seller shall make the property accessible to buyer, buyer's partners, agents, assignees, contractors, da 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 da. The buyer may market the property prior to close of escrow. All right, so this is acknowledging the fact that we may market the property prior to closing on it. Again, we reference again, this agreement is subject to a satisfactory inspection of the property by the buyer. All right, so we've got that in here twice, just in case they try to say they didn't see it, right? So buyer disclosures, we've got that in here as well, all right? Seller acknowledgement, all right, we put this in bold. Just to keep it extremely clear. All right. So seller hereby acknowledges that all negotiations and deadlines with the buyer have been and are at arm's length, and that no duress or undue influence has been exerted by buyer over seller or seller's family in connection with this agreement. So this is saying to the seller when they sign this contract, hey, you were signing this contract at your own free will. Nobody's forcing you to sign it. I'm not making you sell me your house at the price that you're selling it to me at. You're doing it at your own free will, all right? So we want to make sure that's documented and included in our contract. Attorney fees. If legal action is needed to enforce any part of this agreement, the winning party is entitled to reasonable attorney fees and cost. It's a general statement. We like to keep it in there. If you want to take it out, if you're questionable about it, talk with your attorney, all right? So this is the entire agreement. It references that. I want to point this out as well. This agreement must be accepted and signed by seller by 5 p.m. by... Right here, you would simply put what date. So if you're giving them a deadline to accept the contract, all right, then you would put that deadline date right here and then the time that this contract would expire. Now, if you leave this blank, all right, then that means that the contract never expires and they can sign it at any time. You'll have to kind of play that by ear based on your conversations with the seller and what you would like to do here. All right, so guys, this is it, right? Like this is the purchase contract. You sign right here. Again, if there's multiple sellers, then you would just go in here and create a new line and put the other seller in, all right? Or you could put both sellers here and have them both sign on this line. So they'll sign on this line. We use electronic signatures, so we use DocuSign. And then you'll print their names on this side and same here. So your information will go here. You'll sign your name here, and then you'll print your name here. Obviously, we want to date it, all right? But that's the purchase contract. So I want to show you guys now the assignment contract. All right. So we got to assign the contract over to an end buyer in order to get paid. All right. So let's run through this. So the agreement is between. All right. So the assignor would be you. All right. The assignor is the person who has the property under contract, the person who's going to assign it to somebody else. So you would be the assignor. All right, so charged up buyers, LLC, all right? That would be the assignor, and the assignee, okay, would be whoever the end buyer is, end buyer, LLC. All right, let's keep it simple, all right? So end buyer, LLC is the assignee, all right? And so what we're going to do is I'm going to show you exactly how to fill this out so you guys understand. So the assignor has entered into an agreement to purchase real estate with. All right, so guys, here's the deal with this. You're going to go back to your purchase contract. Whoever the seller is who's going to go in that box. All right, so we're going to put the seller in that box because that's who we've gone into a contract with. Under the contract, the assignor has certain rights in the property commonly known as. So we're going to go back. The address is 8811. So you got to put the address here, Mount Olive Avenue. All right, Glen Allen. All right, so again, which is legally described as, so we need that legal description again. All right, so we said it was XYZ legal, all right, since it didn't copy and paste. So whatever that legal description is, like we talked about. So again, legal description right here in PropStream, property details. We scroll down, first tab, legal description. So that would be in that particular box, okay? The next piece is parcel ID. Again, this is also referenced as the APN number. Don't get confused, it's literally the exact same thing, all right? So we would go back in and we would take that parcel ID number and we're gonna also place that here on the assignment contract, all right? So this is going to lay out the terms and condition. Assigner assigns all rights that he acquired under the contract to assignee. All right. So that's saying that all the rights that you have in your original contract, you're assigning all of that over to your cash buyer. Again, remember, assignee is the cash buyer. Assignee accepts all terms and conditions of the contract. So meaning, if you said you were going to pay all the closing costs, the end buyer, your cash buyer, is now, all right, acknowledging that they are taking all those terms. So that would be their cost to absorb. I get this all the time. I see it asked everywhere, Facebook groups, my coaching group, all over the place. Chris, do I have to send a copy of my contract to my cash buyer? This is exactly why you're supposed to send a copy of your contract, because the person is taking over everything you agreed to in your contract. So if they don't see it, they don't even know what they're being assigned. They don't know what they're agreeing to. All right, so any cash buyer likely is going to want to see that. Now, you can black out on your contract your purchase price or whatever the case might be if you like. I don't do that. I know that some people do. Entirely up to you guys, all right? But you're going to want to make sure that if they request a copy of the contract, that you provide it to them so they know what they're accepting. The assignee will deliver to, and you're going to put whoever your closing attorney is. So mine is Dankos Gordon here in Virginia, all right? So I would put Dankos Gordon PC by cashier's check, money, or wire transfer, a non-refundable deposit. All right, so we do a non-refundable deposit with all cash buyers. Our preferred deposit, unless I'm cool with you, all right? So my preferred deposit is $2,500 from the cash buyer. Again, guys, non-refundable. So if your buyer walks, if they do something shady, whatever the case might be, at worst, you'll be able to walk with $2,500, all right? Now, if the contract is canceled for title, seller backs out, whatever the case might be, they're going to be owed this money back. All right. You want this to be a number that's, you know, impactful, but reasonable. $2,500 is a nice sweet spot that we found for cash buyers. Okay. So assignee will pay the assigner a total assignment fee. So whatever your assignment fee is, let's just say it's $5,000. All right. This amount includes the deposit. So $2,500 is already included in that $5,000 from when they made the deposit. All right. So deposit must be provided within 3 calendar days. All right. So again, we would put Dankos Gordon PC right here. All right. Because that's who's going to be facilitating the closing. All right. So the purchase price of the contract. So it says purchase price and underlying transaction. That's $100,000. All right. So we're going to put that here. Our assignment fee is $5,000. All right, if there's an agent involved, you're going to want to put the agent commission in this particular box. All right, but for this conversation, right, there's no agent involved. But if there was, I would put the amount that the agent would be owed right here, and then I would put a parenthesis with whoever that agent is right there. So that's referenced. If they gave a deposit, we're going to reference the deposit right here. All right, and so the total due at closing by the assignee would simply be $100,000 minus $5,000. I'm sorry, plus $5,000. All right, so $105,000. All right, and then it would be minus, and that's why this is in parentheses, minus $2,500 because they've already paid that as their deposit. All right, so the purchase price then would be $102,500. That would be, not purchase price. That would be what would be due at closing by the cash buyer. All right, because again, you're going to get your full $5,000, but they've already paid $2,500 to escrow, so they're only going to need to bring cash to closing of $102,500. Assignee must be close to the underlying transaction by, or must close. All right, so we're going to put whatever date that we want them to close by. All right, so if it's March, I don't know what the day is, the 18th, I think. If we want this to close by March 31st, all right, then we're going to put March 31st, 2021. And then right here, we're going to go back in and we're going to put Dankos Gordon again. All right. And so this is going to be where the closing will occur. So where is your cash buyer going to close. Ideally, you want them to close at your title company. All right. So it says right here that company, Danko's Gordon PC, will represent both the assignee and assignor in closing of their respective transactions. If the assignee fails to close the underlying transaction by the date indicated, they will forfeit their deposit and all rights to the property under the contract will immediately or automatically revert back to the assignor, which is you. All right, assignor must deliver clear title at closing. Got to have clear title. If clear title cannot be given, then this assignment will be canceled and the deposit will be refunded to the assignee. So if you can't close it, can't get done, can't get clear title, they get their $2,500 back. All right, right here is important. Your cash buyer will not contact the seller identified in the contract. Assignee agrees to communicate solely with and through the assignor, again, which is you. Assignor may at any time before closing renegotiate. This is really important, number 10. The assignor may at any time before closing negotiate or renegotiate the underlying purchase price in the contract with the original seller. Assignor is entitled to the entire difference. All right. So guys, what this means is that right now we've got a $5,000 assignment if you were buying it for $100,000. If we went back to the seller and renegotiated the contract and got it at $95,000 after the contract's been assigned, that additional $5,000 that we would gain in profit would not get passed down to your cash buyer. That would increase our assignment fee from $5,000 to $10,000. All right. Assignor makes no representation of the property condition. This includes permitting, major structures, da 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 da. Your cash buyer must do their own due diligence. We're not making any representations, guys. You remember what I teach, all right? When the cash buyer is asking about construction costs, hey, Chris, what do you think the repair estimate is, da 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 da. I tell them all the same thing. Hey, look, I'm not sure. I'm not sure exactly what your vision is. The lockbox code is XYZ. You need to take your contractor by, take a look at the property so that you can come up with whatever you think your repair estimate might be to complete the property to see if it's something that you might be interested in. All right. And so, guys, that's really it. So you come in as the assigner. All right. You sign here. You print your name here. You date it here. Your cash buyer is going to go here, whether it's their LLC, whatever the case might be. This is where they're going to sign. So when you send that electronic signature, they're going to sign right here on that contract or in this assignment agreement. Guys, as simple as that, that's literally how you fill these things out. I wanted to shoot this video. It's one of the biggest questions I get. So this is step-by-step, guys, how you fill this out. Again, I'm giving you my contract and assignment agreement. I usually don't do this. All right, hopefully my students don't kill me because they know I love them. All right, but I want you guys to have this because I see this question asked so much. So if you want to get a copy of this, again, click the link in the description. You can go into your information and you'll be able to download copies of both these documents so that you can use them in your own business. Again, I'm not an attorney, never went to law school. I don't know if I even read a law book. All right. All right. So look, if you want to make changes, talk to your own attorney. Don't hit me up and say, Chris, what about this? Can I add? I don't know. All right. I have no clue. Talk to an attorney, get proper representation, all right? But I want you guys to have this so that you can continue to grow and explode your business. A lot of you guys are working on your first deal. You're not sure which way is up. I've been there before, so I understand. So that's why I'm putting these videos out for you guys to help you on your journey. If you're interested in becoming one of my students, joining Charged Up University, better known as the U, go to startflippingdeals.com. Or click on the link below in the description, watch the replay, click the green button, come join the U family, and let's start making money in 2020 and start getting busy. Let's make it happen, guys. Much love to everybody. Let's get it.